Hello, I'm Rob Brock and I work at KDAB. Welcome back to our mini-series about designing your first embedded Linux device. In this episode, we're going to talk about choosing your hardware. The most difficult decisions you'll make when creating your first embedded Linux device have nothing to do with software. They'll be about the hardware. While it is possible to do a software upgrade mid-development without massive disruption and waste, attempts to make such changes in hardware development come at a much higher cost. As we discussed in the first episode, poor hardware choices at the beginning of a project can have a detrimental impact on the final product. So you need to make some important decisions upfront about which CPU, board, and peripherals you want to use in your device. In this episode, we're going to look at some of the planning considerations that go into choosing your hardware to help you make good hardware choices. We're going to look at picking silicone and board vendors. We'll talk about screens and your UI needs, and finish with a brief section on GUI frameworks. Whilst GUI frameworks are not a hardware topic, we think it's important to consider these topics together. The heart of your product is going to be the CPU. In the embedded world, these are often bundled into one chip with various other computer components to produce a system on chip. These chips are produced by silicone vendors who will often sell them bundled with various configurations of RAM and connectivity options on a system on module. A board vendor may then take these chips or modules and build an embedded computer around them. So, which silicone vendor should you pick? Unfortunately, there's no universal right answer here. You are going to have to consider your performance needs and, from a CPU point of view, what clock speeds might you need? How many cores do you expect to use? The processor die for embedded devices often also contains the GPU and other specialized processors, such as an image signal processor or neural processing unit. If your product needs something specialized, that can significantly cut down the range of devices you have to choose from. If you don't have those constraints, you're still left with a plethora of options and you might be tempted to constrain them by cost. However, we would take this approach with extreme caution. Remember that your choices at this stage can limit the whole project. As we mentioned in episode 1, one of the most common problems we get asked to fix is poor graphics performance. If you pick a low-performance GPU now, you could be setting yourself up for disappointment later. So, how can we mitigate against this? The short answer is build prototypes. Prototype key features or user experiences and test them on candidate hardware to get an idea of how that hardware performs. Then you can make an informed decision when it comes to purchasing larger volumes of hardware. Picking the processor isn't the only decision you have to make. The processor will often come as part of a system on module, which also contains the RAM, often carries the flash storage, and will also constrain your connectivity options to the outside world. By that, we mean that Ethernet, wireless, Bluetooth, and more will live here. If these features aren't available on the system on module and you need them later on, you've made life much harder for yourself. Picking a board vendor can be just as challenging. In fact, it's a good idea to pick your silicone and board vendor at the same time to be sure you can get the configuration you need for your product. To keep this episode brief, we're going to cherry pick a few key points from the print version of the mini-series. The link to the print version is available in the description if you want to know more. The first key point to consider is what operating system the board vendor supports. Do they provide their own operating system? And if so, what customization options are available to you? Do they provide a Yocto project setup? Depending on your product, you might have your own operating system requirements, and we'll touch on these in the next episode. The second key point is to look at what software options are available from the board vendor. For example, Toradex provide Terizon Core, which allows you to package your application into a container. You can then use their platform to deploy your product and manage over-the-air updates, amongst other things. These kinds of extra services can streamline your product development process, but of course they are not free, and they might not be right for everyone. Our last point to make when picking silicone and board vendors is to consider what board support package, or BSP, is available. Does it use an up-to-date Linux kernel? Does the vendor provider have regular releases? This can be very important from a security point of view, as the last thing you want is your product to remain vulnerable to known security issues, even though a fix is available. Additionally, should you find a bug in the BSP whilst developing your product, you want the confidence that the vendor is going to be able to patch and release a new version in a timely manner. If the current BSP is stuck on an ancient version of the Linux kernel, or simply hasn't received any updates for a while, you might find yourself in trouble should your product need a critical update. Not all products require screens, but if yours does, there is a good chance that the success of your product relies on providing a compelling user experience through that screen. If you plan to make use of fancy graphics, for example, smooth animations, high frame rates, 3D assets, or if you simply want a large screen or high pixel density, you need to make sure the GPU you pick is up to the task of driving the display. Do you have enough memory bandwidth to drive your chosen display at your desired refresh rates? Even if you are using less fancy graphics, you still need to consider the physical characteristics of your screen. Does it have the right refresh rate? Is the display readable in all the light conditions you anticipate your product to be used in? Is it rugged enough to survive in your product's working environment? Finally, if your product needs a touchscreen, you need to think about the gestures you want to support. Remember that users have very high expectations of smartphone-like user interfaces. We've worked with many companies who have struggled and failed to improve their sluggish UI. Even the deep software expertise or drastic UI simplification and intense engineering efforts can only deliver incremental improvements when the hardware isn't up to the task. The last topic for this episode is finding the right UI framework. This is a software topic, but we think it is so important to consider alongside your hardware choices that we'll include it in this episode instead of the next. The choice of UI framework depends a lot on the type of graphics you want to display and the programming language you want to use. This, in turn, affects the performance requirements of your hardware. So a device that is perfectly adequate for a Slint UI is not necessarily going to run a HTML-based UI to the same standard. If the software part of your product needs to run on multiple platforms, do you need to beef up your hardware requirements to support a more do-it-all UI framework? Or should you develop your product using different UI toolkits for different platforms? For example, Qt provides great cross-platform support, but might not be able to do lower-end hardware. And of course, you need to consider the licensing implications of each UI framework, as this could incur a per-device cost. Hopefully this episode has set you on the path to good hardware choices. In the next episode, we'll look at choosing your software stack. Thanks for watching, and don't forget there is a link to the print version of this mini-series in the description, and links to our website where you can reach out if you have any questions or need help at any point in your embedded Linux journey. I'll see you next time.